Hi, I'm Stan, KC7XD, our president here, and welcome you all out. So our presenter tonight is Paul Wesling. His call sign is KM6LH. He reminded me at dinner tonight that he likes that because he's left-handed. His presentation tonight is going to consider amateur radio's dramatic impact on the beginnings of Silicon Valley and give somewhat of a colorful history of technology development and innovation that began right here in our neighborhood. He received a degree in engineering and material science from Stanford, and then worked with Univac, MDAL, joined Tandem Computers in 1985. That's right down the street from where I live. Paul retired from HP in 2001. Then he has served as IEEE through this area for many years. He is a life fellow of the IEEE, has received IEEE Centennial Medal, several other IEEE awards and medals. And so, welcome, Paul.
I'm excited to be here tonight. When you leave tonight, you'll understand a little bit better about how Silicon Valley happened and why it depended on ham radio. It's going to be an exciting trip tonight. We'll go through a lot of stuff. Okay, we'll go back to a classic story. The Homebrew Computer Club got started up in Menlo Park. A bunch of hobbyists meeting in Menlo Park, French's garage initially, and then at Slack. And a couple of guys, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, got together, and Woz made a computer, designed it himself using a cheap 6502 processor, because he could get it for $20. I think he bought a pair of them. The story goes that Jobs had to sell his VW van, and Woz sold his HP 65 to get the parts to make those first Apple computers. And they pitched it to the Homebrew Computer Club. A lot of people there supporting it, software, hardware people. They were introduced by a friend, Bill Fernandez, said to Steve Wozniak, and says, oh, you're interested in that? Woz's dad is an engineer. You ought to meet him. That's the story I heard anyway. Is that about right? Okay. So they started up this company. This partnership, called an Apple Computer Company, started in a garage, which is supposed to be what happens for Silicon Valley. And now it's the largest stock market capitalization in the world and the most valuable brand in the world. So how could this happen, and why did it happen in a backwater like the San Francisco Bay Area? That's what we're going to work on tonight. We're going to walk through that and see what happened. Because before 1900, it was called the Valley of Heart's Delight. And you all live around here. The blossoms in the valley in the spring from all the prunes and apricots and so on really was beautiful. And our product was cherries and prunes, things like that. And we shipped them all over the world. And in 1987, Senator Leland Stanford said, someday you will see Palo Alto blooming with nearly all the flowers of the earth and the fruits and shade trees of every zone. In the future, we shall can this fruit and send it all over the globe in exchange for wealth, which they did. A refrigerated boxcar had been invented, but soon technology overcame agriculture as our main product here in the valley. Let's go back. Federal Telegraph was formed in 1909 by Cyril Elwell, a Stanford grad. He hired Lee DeForest, who invented the vacuum tube, the Audion vacuum tube, back in 1907. He escaped some financial issues in New York and came west for a few years and worked at Federal Telegraph. And I'm going to pass around this. You online can see this, but I'm going to pass this around. This is an original Audion from 1914. And Lee DeForest invented that. So pass that around. Be gentle with it. That was the first vacuum tube. Got things moving. Federal Telegraph got started really with the arc transmitter, which you see in the upper right here. The arc transmitter uses a magnetic field to get an oscillating signal. Well, oscillating, that's CW, that's continuous wave. We like that sort of thing. And he got some angel investors together, including David Starr Jordan, the president of Stanford, and Charles Marks, the geology professor, John Caspar Branner. Each of them kicked in about $500, which would be like $30,000, $40,000 maybe today, something like that, to help him get started. And he demonstrated solid communication from San Francisco to Honolulu and back in 1912, which is this lower right cartoon from the Star newspaper. So here we have our first sort of venture capital and Stanford's professors and staff getting involved with their graduates and helping them develop a new company. Well, by the 1920s, Federal Telegraph had three high-power stations in Portland, San Francisco, and Los Angeles, and they weren't selling radio equipment so much as a service. So if you had a shipping company like the Dollar Steamship Line, you could communicate to your ships at sea, and they could communicate with you pretty much throughout the Pacific Ocean. And there's a plaque at the corner of Channing and Emerson in Palo Alto commemorating this. Another thing that happened back in there, Doc Herhold was a student at Stanford. He started a company in San Francisco, which was destroyed by the San Francisco earthquake. So he decided to start a school for radio people out behind what's now the Fairmont Hotel to teach radio arts. He started this in 1909. And he had the first scheduled radio broadcast in the United States called San Jose Calling. The station, he gave it a call sign FN, which eventually became KCBS, our clear channel station here. And so there's another one of these experimenters in those early days. A third one, Otis Moorhead, another Stanford grad, liked this idea of vacuum tubes. And he started his own company in 1919. There's a picture here of some of the tubes he's turning out. They're testing them, verifying them. And he manufactured bootleg receiving tubes. Well, you can do this for maybe 50 or 100 parts, but if you start making 500, somebody might notice. And the companies back east noticed he was making these, duplicating their tubes, and they shut him down. They filed a patent infringement lawsuit and shut him down. This is going to be an interesting theme, that this intellectual property becomes a very important theme in our story. Well, some of the defining events in those days, the private wealth from the California Gold Rush created a lot of wealth in the San Francisco Bay Area. The Titanic sinking in 1912 brought to a head the idea that ships had to have ship-to-shore and ship-to-ship radio that was reliable. So this put a lot of funds into developing this technology. Then in World War I, the Navy found out that radio was very important for their operations. And so they pushed ship-to-shore and communication modes, and they wanted to take over that technology and control it. And the economics were also good, because instead of having to lay a cable or have four dozen telegraph lines going between two cities, it would have been easy if you could just jump over that with a wireless technology and go point to point and not have to go under the ocean or something like that. So all of this brought a lot of funding to the San Francisco Bay Area. We're going to follow three of those early pioneers. Bill Eitel, W6UF, Jack McCullough, W6CHE, and Charlie Litton came from Bay Area families. They were born and raised here, local kids. Here's a picture of Charlie Litton, 11 years old, outside what he calls his wireless house. He's experimenting in his backyard with amateur radio. Well, Bill Eitel took shops at Los Gatos High School. He worked in his father's quarry over the summer as a blacksmith and a machine operator. This was up in the Santa Cruz Mountains. And in the summertime, he had a job over at the Hull-Scott Motor Car Company. His uncle owned that over in Oakland, where he operated complex machinery. So he had a good hands-on background from his high school days in technology and making things. Jack McCullough and Charlie Litton went to the California School of Mechanical Arts, which we know as Lick Wilmerding High School now. It was opened in 1895 by James Lick so that boys and girls with technical talent and a hands-on approach could get a rigorous education in the mechanical arts. And Litton said he got a realistic feel for materials and processes and design and things like that during high school at the California School of Mechanical Arts. Well, McCullough continued at a local junior college, and Litton enrolled in Stanford's mechanical engineering department, because in those days, there was no electrical engineering department. You majored in chemical engineering or mechanical engineering. And then once you got your bachelor's degree, as your engineer's degree, you could pick one of the four or five electrical fields like power or transmission to major in. So typically, Gordon Moore, for example, majored in chemical engineering. Anyway, he got his bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering in 1924, about the time that Terman hit the campus from MIT. And he took Stanford's first course, Communication Engineering Fundamentals, from Fred Terman. Got all excited about this idea that this communications technology might be the wave of the future. Well, they were introduced to ham radio through their family and friends in the 1910s and 1920s. And in those days, ham radio in our San Francisco Bay Area was pretty isolated. We had a maritime focus because we had these steamship lines coming in and out of the bay, and they needed a lot of radio operators. So there were jobs. When they started licensing amateurs in the early 1920s, we had about 1,200 here, which was about 10% of the nation's total, which was clearly a bubble. In those days, they didn't recognize that as a bubble, but something was going on here in the Bay Area with radio. Well, it was an active center of radio production in the 1910s and 20s. We had Magnavox. They started up in Napa Valley and moved to Oakland, making loudspeakers, Jensen and so on. Heinz and Kaufman designed custom radio equipment, what we think of as HF equipment. Federal Telegraph, I mentioned, produced radio transmitters, the ARC transmitters. We'll see more of them a little bit later. Up to 1 million watt transmitters, and they had them in the Canal Zone, in Spain, in Virginia, around the Pacific Ocean for commercial use, but also the Navy put in a whole network of these. And plus, there were a lot of jobs for radio amateurs and a lot of parts running around. Just like you've got a junk box in your garage, there were lots of parts available. And so it became a place where if you were a young fellow and wanted to get into this sort of thing, you could find people who would help you, find parts, operate people's equipment. And the ham radio subculture, as you know, is one of kind of camaraderie and sociability, where it's easy to make friends. It's easy to communicate over the air. Most nerds like me would rather look at our shoes and talk about radio than talk about ourselves. But face-to-face, we even do that pretty well, too. So the idea is that we operate together. We work together as kind of a hobby and help each other out. It's very egalitarian. And so there's very little distinction to class or education level or things like that. And Bill Eitel said when he headed up the Santa Clara County Radio Club, he said, "We had farm boys and Stanford students and Federal Telegraph technicians and retired executives all working together in this hobby, trying to do something a little bit better, make something better, teach each other." Much contrasted to what companies did, and especially monopolistic type companies, it was more of a grassroots thing that was taking hold here because of this ham radio culture. And there was an interest in extending this radio technology. For example, if you wanted to become well-known in your radio club, you might build something new, a new antenna, or make some improvements, or talk to somebody further away, maybe all the way to Idaho or something. So there's a mix of competitiveness, trying to do something bigger and better than everybody else has done, trying to expand what can be done. But then once you've done it, it's collaboration. It's helping other people do it. Like with the Apple computer, when Woz brought it up to Slack and showed it around, his objective was just to have other people make them too. Hey, the parts are available. Let's get together and make a bunch of these things. I think it was Jobs that had this idea that maybe there's a business in this. Anyway, what we were doing in the Santa Clara Valley here back in the 1920s and so on is much like what happened at the Homebrew Computer Club, and a lot like what happens in Silicon Valley today. What you don't see, the little companies, the little people getting together and building little startups that may develop into something really big. Well, there's another young pioneer, Fred Terman. He moved to Los Angeles from the Midwest. He was about 6 years old at the time. His dad, Lewis Terman, was hired by San Bernardino High School to be their principal. Well, I went to San Bernardino High School, although he wasn't my principal. This was before my time. But then he got hired away by Los Angeles Normal School, which we know today of as UCLA. And he spent a year or so there. And then they noticed him from Stanford. So Stanford hired him to go into their education department at Stanford. And so he set up the Lewis Terman set up the Stanford-Binet IQ test that many of you may have taken in the 60s, 70s, 80s. Anyway, young Fred Terman is like 6, 8 years old, maybe 10 or 12. And Herbert Hoover, who was an early graduate of Stanford, first year, first class, and was a mining engineer, had come back from China fairly rich and settled in across the street from the Termans. And so we've got Herbert Hoover Jr., about 14 years old, and young Fred Terman, and George Branner, the son of the civil engineering professor, and Jack Franklin, the son of the chemistry professor. And Herbert Hoover Jr. said, all three of us were neighbors, and upon pushing the key of one of our imposing contraptions would holler out the window to see if it had been received on the other side of the street. So they're experimenting as teenagers with this, much as your teenagers may very well be making websites or developing apps. It's the same kind of thing. We see here Herbert Hoover Jr. in 1923 with his ham set up, and here he is as president of the ARL in 1963. Young Fred Terman said if you saw a 90-foot pole sticking up somewhere, you'd go and knock on the door and get acquainted with him, because obviously it's a radio operator, and maybe they've got some pieces you can have, or that you can operate their equipment or learn something from them. And as a high schooler, he hung around at Federal Telegraph, which was a few blocks down El Camino from Stanford, and worked there one summer. There's a couple of streets now in San Jose, a freeway and so on, named for Fred Terman. But here's Fred Terman. He's got a Harvard banner, but he's got a Stanford banner in there too. So he's operating his ham radio. Well, let's follow our hobbyists. Itel, Litton, and McCullough and their ham friends experimented with vacuum tubes. They were fairly new in those days. Not very good. You could build your own, though. They built a lot of their own parts. I remember as a kid, I got an oatmeal box and wound an inductor for my AM radio. So those are the kinds of things you can do in your basement. And they made some notable contributions. In 1924, Litton, with the Stanford Radio Club, made the first radio contact across the Pacific to Australia and New Zealand. And in 1928, Itel pioneered the 10-meter band for transcontinental communications. They're starting to work up higher in those useless bands that the U.S. government gave to them to work in. Well, Litton got a job at a local company, Federal Telegraph, which we were talking about, through a ham friend. And it had built up to about 60 engineers. This is their main business, main building here at the Perham House. And then Lee DeForest and his two technicians had this building back here from about 1911 to 1913. And they became a supplier to International Telephone and Telegraph. I stress international. This is not AT&T, it's IT&T. And they became a supplier of equipment, radios, and so on to Spain and China and a lot of other different countries around the world. Bill Itel, meanwhile, got a job through a ham friend at Heinz and Kaufman. Heinz, W6RH, was a ham, and he hired a lot of hams. And their focus was high-performance HF radio equipment, which they sold around the world also. And they recruited McCullough a year later to join Heinz and Kaufman. Well, the tube business in those days was interesting. General Electric, Westinghouse, and AT&T pretty much were the tube makers. AT&T had bought Lee DeForest's right to the Audion tube, and turned that into a big operation, making tubes, designing better tubes. They were all East Coast companies, and they developed some high-power transmitting tubes in the early 1920s. They're difficult to produce. They're touchy. It's hard to keep a vacuum in them. After a month or two, you might lose vacuum. You might have impurities in there that cause it to be unreliable. Anyway, they weren't that great, and they required precise machining, glass blowing, Pyrex glass, exotic materials, pretty sophisticated sealing techniques. They weren't easy to make. Well, the difficulty for our West Coast companies, they were selling internationally, and the Navy and General Electric decided they really wanted to keep this technology local in the United States. So they set up a new company called Radio Corporation of America, or RCA, to ensure U.S. dominance in this field. So RCA, GE, Western Electric, which is AT&T, and Westinghouse did a cross-licensing agreement. They signed all their patents over to RCA and cross-licensed them, about 2,000 patents in radio. And they became the sole producers and distributors of power grid tubes, which were needed by our companies out here. And they would not sell to the Bay Area firms because we didn't keep our technology local. And it was also seen as a threat to RCA's monopoly. So we had some real problems out here. Both companies needed to develop their own triode tubes. And Litton headed up one tube outfit, and Itel headed up the other tube shop. So here we have these two fellows heading up the task of trying to develop their own tubes. There were about 250 key RCA patents that they had to design around and not violate, which was pretty difficult. So they hired locally. A lot of the people they hired were already hams. They knew something about radio and engineering. And Itel and Litton collaborated with each other, which was kind of novel in those days. If you were at one company, you would not share anything with another company. But these were little companies trying to survive. Plus, there were a couple of friends that were used to this idea of getting together and sharing, this collaboration idea. So they worked closely together as they developed these tubes. They also worked closely with their patent attorneys, first of all, to be sure they weren't violating any patents, and secondly, to patent the stuff that they were developing. So they had some challenges. They developed a new rugged power tube using new materials because the old ones were patented, new manufacturing methods, shock-resistant seals developed by Litton, a higher vacuum. Litton developed the oil vacuum pump, which gave them a lot better reliability. So they had more reliable and longer lifetime than the RCA tubes. But the key thing was they didn't infringe the RCA patents, so they could go ahead and make those tubes without being challenged. And Litton, always the practical guy, invented what was called the glass lathe. Some of you may have worked with lathes and when you were younger, making lamps and things like that, turning wood and so on. This is similar. The idea was you would put your glass blank on there and build your tube on this axis of symmetry. You'd have very good repeatability. You'd seal it also on that same axis there. So you had one operation. It was fast. It was very precise to make these tubes. And it was built in a building on the back of his property, which we sort of grandfather into a garage and say, well, he's sort of a Silicon Valley garage guy. But so it was Litton that developed this technology to build these. Now we're into the 1930s and we have a depression in the United States. And so Federal Telegraph was sold and moved to the East Coast. In this picture here, you see Leonard Fuller. This is a pole piece for their million watt magnetic arc transmitter. And so you can see these are pretty hefty things, bigger, much bigger than tube transmitters. Leonard Fuller was the chief engineer at Federal Telegraph, and he was Stanford's first PhD EE, but he went on to lead UC Berkeley's electrical engineering school. But over in Berkeley, he remembered that there were a couple of these big, colossal machines sitting out in the rain in Palo Alto. And he said to Ernest Lawrence, he says, you've got this nice 6-inch cyclotron, great idea. What could you do with a 42-inch magnet? Okay. So they wound it with the copper, developed that magnet, turned into a cyclotron at UC Berkeley, which developed into 6 Nobel Prizes by 1960. So here again, we have this sharing. Here's Leonard Fuller giving this leftover magnet from his radio to Ernest Lawrence at Berkeitel. Okay, so Eitel and McCullough left Heinz and Kaufman, which had shut down, decided to build high-power, high-frequency tubes, mainly with the idea of building them for radio operators like ourselves, for amateurs. But he didn't have enough money, so he needed some financing. Well, Harrison was a real estate agent in San Bruno, and Preddy had some theaters up in San Francisco, and they each kicked in $20,000. And Eitel and McCullough brought their know-how, and they split the company 50-50. Harrison and Preddy put in $20,000. One of them cashed out before World War II with about $80,000 or $90,000. The other one cashed out in the late 40s for about $150,000. So they made money on their investment. But you see here a sharing of profits, of ownership and profit, and a precursor to today's Menlo Park venture capital firms up on Sand Hill Road with local people who have some money, just like in the much earlier days, the gold rush money, being able to fund some of these operations. Well, I mentioned that they cooperated closely in the tube development work at their companies, but they also did it later. So Eitel and McCullough set up their company, IMAC, we know it as, set up their vacuum tube shop, and Litton gave them castings for his lathe and the engineering blueprints. He says, make more of these. This is what you need to make these tubes. And so they freely exchanged technical and commercial information back and forth, much like we think of the ham community, which reduced the risks for these two small tube-related businesses. Most companies that you read about in the paper from Silicon Valley are huge because they've got publicists, but most of the companies are pretty small. They're doing their specialized thing, working with other specialized companies to try to achieve the goals of what they're after. One of the tubes that IMAC did come up with, I'll pass this one around, is the, you're familiar with this from the late 60s, the Z300. Take a look at that baby. So this is what tubes developed into. During the Depression in 1936, Fred Terman asked Charlie Litton to join Stanford's EE department as a lecturer and to help out in the labs to explain how things work, be a practical guy. And so he spent time with the students and staff on the campus. And as part of one of the awards for a Klystron patent, Sperry, back in New York, gave $1,000 to Charlie Litton. And Charlie says, well, I don't really need it. Let's give it to Fred Terman. He can do something with it. So Terman had a couple of graduates. One of them was Dave Packard, who had gone back to General Electric and was working there. And he said to Dave, he says, why don't you and Lucille come out to California? I've got $500 you can live on and $500 for lab equipment. Well, that's a tough decision because it's the Depression and jobs are kind of scarce, but Dave Packard packs up and comes back. Bill Hewlett finishes his master's degree at MIT and comes back. And Fred Terman gets them together, Litton working with them too, with Hewlett and Packard, and they formed Hewlett-Packard, the first, we think it maybe is the first big company that got started here. There's the garage where it started. So here we again see this university-industry cooperation, which complements this ham ethos of the Valley and makes it really a hotbed for entrepreneurialism. Well, in the late 30s, there was a threat to peace, and we saw Japan and Germany rearming, and President Roosevelt wanted to rebuild the Army and Navy. So he was putting some money into this. And over in England, there was a new technology developed called radio detection and ranging, or radar. It was running at what we think of as HF frequencies, huge antennas, and you could bounce this signal out there and bounce it off something. You could kind of see there was something out there, kind of big, but you couldn't tell what it was. What they really needed to do was go to higher frequencies for more precision and higher power for better signals. So the only tubes that worked at those higher frequencies they needed were the IMAC tubes. They worked best at the high voltages because us hams like to work at 800 and 1,000 volts and things like that. And at the higher frequencies, the 100 megahertz, the 200 megahertz frequencies and above, which eventually up to the microwave. Here's the IMAC 50T. Tube, one of those tubes from those days. Well, Russell and Sigurd Varian were a couple of Palo Alto kids. They were they liked technology. Sigurd liked to try to invent stuff, and Russ liked to make stuff. And so Russell and Sigurd were worried about Germany. They thought, wouldn't it be nice if we could actually use microwaves to detect these planes? Because then you could really tell in much more detail how far they were, how fast they were moving, maybe even what kind of plane they were. So in 1937, they moved to Stanford's labs, working for Bill Hansen in the physics department, and they developed the Klystron in 1937. This is about a 20 kilowatt Klystron. They started out much smaller. And they were using Litton's free advice. Here again, we have a real practical guy. Russ Varian would have some ideas. He'd go in and talk to Bill Hansen and say, we can try this and this and this. And Bill Hansen would say, well, that won't work and that won't work, but try this. So over a period of months and maybe a year and a half, they developed this Klystron with Hansen's theoretical assistance and with Litton helping with how to actually make this stuff. I think of it as an integrated circuit because it's a several tuned cavities, and but integrated circuit means something else these days. So we'll just call it a Klystron. Anyway, probably only in Stanford and the Palo Alto Times did you see a headline like this. Well, first of all, you've got our president here talking about building up the Army and Navy, and we got this guy, Adolf Hitler, warning, leave us alone, just give us one more country, give us Czechoslovakia, and we'll stop. But the main headline here is new Stanford radio invention heralds revolutionary changes, and we see Sigurd and Russ Varian here in the announcement of the Klystron. So there's a big wartime expansion now, building up into World War II. Stanford was a microwave hotbed, the whole Bay Area. The tube guy's book back there has a whole litany of what happened in those days and what companies relocated here, including General Electric, to make high-power tubes. And they developed a very progressive approach to business, as you might expect, being based upon kind of an egalitarian idea. Relations within and between companies were much more progressive. Managerial techniques they developed tended to thwart unions, kept employees happy and productive. For example, they developed profit sharing, tuition reimbursement. They had cafeterias. Kaiser Shipbuilding put in cafeterias. They started medical clinics so their people would stay healthy, developed into the Kaiser Permanente health plan that we know today. There was the HP Way philosophy, which explained how you should work in your community with your employees, with your products. And that's a good thing to study if you're interested in starting your own company. But it was similar to what we saw at Hewlett-Packard and Fairchild and Intel. I was at Tandem Computers, and I remember the first week you're at Tandem, you go to class to learn all about the Tandem environment. And one of the things they told us was, if somebody comes up with a new idea in a meeting, you can't say anything bad about it for 5 minutes. You have to say, well, we could get product engineering to do this. We could try that. You can't shoot it down, because in a company, if you've got a vice president that says, that's a dumb idea, that guy's never going to come up with another idea for you again. He might leave and have his own ideas. But the idea was, in the Valley here, at least at Tandem, we wanted new ideas to pop up and percolate. We wanted them to come to fruition if it was possible. So that was one of our rules at Tandem. Very interesting environment here. Out of Hewlett-Packard, we got Tandem and a bunch of other companies. Well, post-war realignment, RCA focused on TV and broadcast and formed a network called the National Broadcasting Corporation. It's still sort of a conglomerate, I think. IMAC went on to develop a new line of better tubes, mainly for hobbyists and hams, for much higher frequencies, for VHF, UHF, and so on. And the FCC was going to put a new frequency modulation radio system in at about 50 megahertz, our 6 meter band. But when they came out with it, it was actually at 100 megahertz, 88 to 108 megahertz. Well, that was an interesting problem because RCA's broadcasting tubes wouldn't work at that frequency. We have a real problem now. So RCA did the next best thing. They copied the IMAC tubes, which did work at that frequency. Ah, we've got a solution. I think you can see where this is leading. So in 1947, IMAC sued RCA and General Electric, alleging patent infringement. And RCA lost the lawsuit, had to halt production, and became basically the marketing force for IMAC. So IMAC would make the tubes, they'd stamp RCA on the side and ship them to RCA, which I think RCA and NBC didn't really care too much. They would much rather be in broadcasting than making tubes. But anyway, that became a big item for IMAC. They could resell these tubes under these GE or whatever names. So the big dog now in microwave tubes, and especially the high-power tubes used for UHF TV stations, was Silicon Valley. Well, after the war, Charlie Litton thought, these klystrons are pretty neat. And so he started doing research in that and worked with Bill Hansen, who developed the linear accelerator at Stanford, the little one, the Mark I, the Mark II, and so on. And they scaled the klystron from 30 kilowatts up to 30 megawatts. Because remember, it's just an integrated circuit. Just make the things bigger, and you don't have, it's not like a tube. It's more like an IC. And you could get the power out. It was kind of nice. And so he transformed Stanford into a major player, and they got a contract from the U.S. government, $214 million, to build this two-mile-long linear accelerator, which we drive over on 280 every time we go up to San Francisco. And today, if anybody gets cancer treatment, that radiation therapy uses a Litton klystron. So in 2022, they added a couple of mile superconducting particle accelerators to this. They kept increasing its capability, but the idea was it was based upon the klystron that was developed leading up to World War II by the Varian brothers. Well, the Varians started their own company, and they didn't call it Varian Corporation. They called it Varian Associates, because they didn't really want to be hierarchical. They wanted to just be eight friends doing this stuff together, Ginson and the different guys that were in there. And they started up in Menlo Park. They got a piece of property, and they grew. They had chickens in the backyard, so if they didn't have any products to sell, they could sell eggs. But it was just a kind of a, almost a commune, because the Varians actually grew up for a few years in Halcyon, which is a bit of a commune down along the coast. Anyway, Varian Associates was selling microwave equipment, and they developed several pieces of measurement gear that they could use during production. Well, in 1948, they sold the plans for this instrumentation to Hewlett-Packard for $20,000. They said, would you guys like to buy this plan? We'll show you how to make it. And HP says, that would increase our product line from oscillators and things like that. So they did. They invested some money in it, started the Santa Rosa division, the Santa Clara division, became Agilent, which at the time was the biggest IPO when it went public. Now it's Keysight. Here again, we have people working together. I've got this nice equipment. Would you like to take it over and make a product line out of it? So we still see Bill and Dave down here back in the early days. And this was their first audio oscillator. There's a nice example of these in the basement of the engineering center at Stanford. Well, this is a mural up in Palo Alto in Courthouse Square. And it sort of depicts what happened graphically over those years. We've got Stanford in the background. But over here, you'll see this large pull piece for this arc transmitter. And here's Leonard Fuller and Cyril Elwell talking to Ernest Lawrence, looking at their cyclotron. Here's Lee DeForest with his Audion tube, the one you just passed around. We've got Charles Doc Herhold over here broadcasting to his students in San Jose. Every Wednesday night, they would have a half-hour program called San Jose Calling. And he would talk to his students who were building their radios and listening. And his wife would go down to the local record store and find out what records came in, and she'd play records over the air. So she was the first DJ. And so, in fact, this is her over here listening to the radio. We've got Charlie Litton at his glass lathe here, Fred Terman, and Dave Packard and Bill Hewlett over here. Philo Farnsworth invented the first all-electronic TV tube up the peninsula. We've got McCullough and Itel back here. So it pulls this technology thread together of what happened in those early years in the 10s, 20s, 30s, 50s, and so on. And in fact, if you go up in Palo Alto, you can see these cubicles here as a printer and desk and so on. And here's the mural up on the wall. And so if you're up there during business hours at Sheraton and Birch, you can drop in and see this mural. Let's fast forward to the 1950s. William Shockley was raised in Palo Alto. Here he is with his dog at his house in Palo Alto. Went to Caltech, then to MIT, and went to AT&T's Bell Labs, where he and his cohorts invented the transistor, several types of transistor, as a matter of fact, with the idea that maybe it could be a solid-state version of a vacuum tube, not use as much power, maybe be more reliable. Well, it resulted in a Nobel Prize in 1956. And I'm not going to tell this story, but Silicon Valley should have been in New Jersey, which is where the transistor was invented. But it wasn't. We did it out here. So he left the East Coast. He wasn't real happy with Bell Labs, and they didn't give him enough laudatory acclamation. He went back to Caltech and taught for a year or so. And Arnold Beckman said, hey, I'll fund a transistor company. You can start a silicon transistor company and locate it in Culver City, and I'll fund it for you. And William Shockley says, Culver City? I don't think so, because his mom came from Palo Alto, and he was still here, and he grew up in Palo Alto. So he came up here and started it in Mountain View, about 100 yards from Palo Alto, in 1955. He was a heck of a guy to work for. So finally, after a couple of years, the Traitorous Eight left and formed Fairchild, which is the first that we saw, the first real venture capital funding. And their key development was the planar process, because to make diffuse transistors, they made it much simpler to be able to make a bunch of them at once rather than one at a time. But it required special infrastructure, high vacuum technology. We've got that. Precise furnaces. We've got that here in the valley. Glass blowing and quartz machining. We've got machinists that can machine quartz. Ultra pure gases and water. Litton was an expert at process control and that sort of thing. And so the ICs were built here as well as the transistors, because we had the technology here based upon what we had done in vacuum tubes and the technology that accompanied that. And Isaac Asimov, the science fiction writer, said one time, he said, the planar process is the most important moment since man emerged as a life form, which maybe is a bit of an exaggeration, but when you look at your cell phone and think there's 100 million transistors in there, maybe a billion, it's amazing what you can do with this planar process. It's become quite the standard. So at the end, the situation had changed dramatically. The peninsula, the San Francisco area, was a major electronic center for tubes. As I mentioned, semiconductors, ICs, half the microwave tubes were built up in San Carlos and Belmont. They were in every advanced weapons and space systems. We saw them in radar ranges. I guess women didn't want radar in their kitchen, so we called them microwave ovens. But that was originally the radar range. And so we became the center of the defense and manufacturing economy. And the question is, why here? Why did it happen here? Well, first of all, the East has large vertically integrated firms. We think of IBM and DEC and Raytheon and so on. Big companies that like to protect their markets, like to be vertically integrated to build all of their own stuff. DEC had their computers. They made their own disk drives, their own tape drives, their own everything, our own software. And they had to protect those. Plus, it's hard to bring in a new technology because you've got all this other stuff has to be made new also. So it gives you quite an anchor to hold you back. Whereas Silicon Valley, we're highly fragmented and decentralized. A bunch of people just working at their hobbies and helping each other. A lot of specialized firms, engineering driven, with a network of small and medium firms that can help you out. They can do your accounting. They can do your machining. They can do all this kind of stuff. Another great advantage we have, California passed a law that says we will not enforce non-compete clauses. So I can work for somebody and I can't take their secrets with me, but I can leave and start my own competing company or go to a competitor and they can't sue me. Well, they can sue me, but they can't win because the Supreme Court will throw it out. There are only five states that have non-compete clause prohibitability. And so this lets us be a lot more rapid. If I want to hire a good engineer in Columbus, Ohio from somebody, I can't do it because they'll get sued. They have to wait a year before they can work for me. Out here, very quick. So this new environment is great if you're entrepreneurial or fast moving because it allows you to move fast. You don't have to move slowly like a monopoly or a large vertically integrated company would. So these were developed over the last 100 years, these competencies that we had here in the 60s and 70s. And I described the analog area, but these hobbyists and collaboration sharing people worked into the digital area, software. We developed biotech here, the very first bio company, mobile computing, big data, deep learning and machine learning, virtual and augmented reality, and now autonomous vehicles. It's all here. It's elsewhere also, but it's certainly here. So we have a large number of cutting-edge entrepreneurs with a lot of engineers and venture capitalists willing to fund them. Good local universities turning out people that are practical. We also are supported by the role models that we have and expectations. My son and a neighbor across the street went to high school and college together. He became a partner in Kleiner Perkins. So you expect this of your neighbors. You know, we've got so many, a lot more engineers and nerds per square mile than any place else. Like you can get a Steve Wozniak with a Steve Jobs just because they're a few blocks apart in New York or in Ohio or Illinois. That doesn't happen. You don't have that critical mass. So we became this culture of innovation. So we had Shockley's first company. So I've got a question for you. Some of you probably have an Apple iPhone or a Macintosh. Why do they call the intelligent agent there Siri? Well, it's because SRI is too hard to pronounce. So they called it Siri. It was developed at SRI. A couple of guys left. Apple bought their company and they just kept the name Siri. Hewlett Packard was formed in the 40s and 50s. We had universities. The 60s, we have real semiconductor companies. We got AMD, National Semiconductor, Intel, Intersil. We've now got a company, Applied Materials, that just makes equipment to make semiconductors. Then in the 70s, we get real computer companies. We've got my company, Tandem Computers. We've got Apple forming, Amdahl Corporation. I was there for 7 years developing an IBM-compatible mainframe. Atari, we've got video games that you can haul around, and then eventually for your home. I mentioned genetic engineering. Genentech is formed. It's kicked off about $300 million split between UCSF and Stanford over the last years for developing the recombinant DNA patent. So we've got all of this happening. In the 80s, we have software companies. Who would have thought you could sell software? The computer club, the homebrew computer club, thought you should just give the punch tapes to each other and share it. Except I think Bill Gates got kind of mad about that, didn't he? He wrote a nasty gram saying, I think you got to give some money to the people who make the software. Anyway, we have Adobe making this wonderful image editing software. You've got Cisco setting up routers now to make the internet. Sun Microsystems and MIPS making, and Silicon Graphics making workstations. So we've got all these new developments coming along in the 80s. In the 90s, we've got Google and Facebook. We've got Netflix starting up, Salesforce, software as a service, Pandora, music. And so I mentioned automotive and vehicles. All of the major auto companies have their autonomous driving stuff here in the Santa Clara Valley. Ford has several hundred engineers in the industrial park at Stanford. GM bought Cruise Automation in San Francisco. Toyota is investing $1 billion, most of it here, some of it in Massachusetts, in this development. Samsung was kind of an interesting case. They, of course, are a Korean company that makes dishwashers and computers and phones and everything. And they like to buy these little hot companies. And they say, well, would you like to move to Seoul, Korea? And they say, I don't think so. So they built a building. It's about a 7-story building or 10-story building. And they say, okay, you're on the third floor in the south wing and you're on the second floor in the north wing. And they're populating it with this as their development center. That's how they went about it. Walmart, this little supermarket from Arkansas, throughout the last 25 years has developed their software up the peninsula. And streaming and biotech, I mentioned that. I'm going to skip over this one. But where is Silicon Valley? If you look at a map, you discover it's right there. But really, it's more of a metaphysical space, because when they say Uber is a Silicon Valley company, that's a San Francisco company. So Silicon Valley now includes Scotts Valley, San Francisco, East Bay. It's kind of a metaphorical space. And there were a lot of mottos that some of the startups had, like think different over at Apple, get in over your head, impossible is nothing. Move fast and break things. I'm not going to say who that was. What would you do if you weren't afraid? This idea that you're really invested in it. And it's kind of a grassroots, bottom-up approach. Thomas Friedman, one of my favorite columnists, said, in Silicon Valley, great collaborators are prized. In Washington, D.C., they are hanged. When they say collaborator, they mean traitor. You know, Democrats talking to Republicans. But here in Silicon Valley, they mean colleague. This goes back to those ham radio roots. And we say in Silicon Valley, it's our attitude. Failure is a feature, not a bug. Fail fast, get on to the next thing. And as Yoda said, do or do not. There is no try. You know, you're 100% invested in your new startup with your two partners. So there are a number of good books on this. I brought a few along with me. Making Silicon Valley is a good one to read if you want to go back to those days. The Tube Guys is a fun book, especially for hams, because he goes through a lot of the developments in early tubes, explains them, and then talks about a lot of the companies from around here. And then Annalise Saxanian's book talks about Silicon Valley compared to Boston's Route 128. Why did one succeed and the other one kind of wither away? Especially if you want to start something up, that's a good book to read to get a feel for what the advantages are. And Margaret O'Mara up at University of Washington has a book called Cities of Knowledge, where she compares Stanford and the environment around it to the University of Pennsylvania and what was going on there, and Georgia Tech and its Atlanta environment. So I think this gives you an understanding of the tech roots that developed in the Silicon Valley that came out of ham radio, why it became so important, why it's the center of technology development for the world, and why I think it'll stay that way. It's because of what we instilled as hams in this environment to make it work that way. So thank you very much, and I'll take questions. One of the things that I remember back in the early days, back in the late 60s, I guess, there was kind of a countercultural movement here in the Bay Area that developed into a lot of experimenting and so on. And we had Captain Crunch with his blue boxes making that stuff illicitly. That was John Draper. And he was around here for a long time. We had Doug Engelbart at SRI, who developed the mouse, the graphical user interface. I had the opportunity a couple of years ago to help bring up an Xerox PARC Alto computer, the big vertical screen and the huge bay of electronics and the big disk drive and so on. And that was one of the very first personal computer. But we had quite a few technologies in those days. What do you have some comments on that? Was that You remember from those days?
And there's one other factor left out, which is we have the venture capital community. The venture capital was a big thing. And as digital started just taking over the world economically and growing, the venture capitalists who made money in the industry would invest in other digital companies all over the country. But they got tired of flying four times a year to board meetings out in Boston. And then they started, if you had a company you wanted to start in Pittsburgh, they said, you can start your company, we'll fund it, but you have to do it in Silicon Valley. And I kind of missed, you know, having grown up here when it was all just portraits.
You still get that.
The definition of Silicon Valley was the valley where silicon came into importance. The software industry just kind of moved all over the bay.
It did. It spread out. I remember there was a company in France I read about a couple of years ago. It was trying to get venture capital. They got the first seed or two rounds, but they couldn't get big venture capital until they actually moved their headquarters to Silicon Valley, and then they got funding. And this is true across the country. You can get small companies started up, but you keep growing there. It's very difficult.
Yeah, all around the world, they look that way, although now it's spreading out so well. Yeah. But, yeah, it was, I don't know, it's just the whole group computer club, for example, was I was so astounded by a lot of stuff I didn't know about the ham radio people and the collaborations and young people of a certain age and going back through my own life. And so the homebrew computer club was all about give it to others or raising your hand. I'd like this and somebody would help you out with it. It was all just helping. And that's why I built my computer. Steve Jobs didn't know it existed. He was out of state.
Mm-hmm.
And I took it down to the homebrew computer club and I passed out my designs with no copyright notes. Made it public domain to everyone there because these are the people that will start a revolution. And that was very similar to some of the things you went through with the radio folk. But radio was so important a part of my life. If I had been a ham, I don't know I would have ever got to Apple.
And also the Stanford Artificial Intelligence Lab. Sale.
That one,
we went back there once.
Yeah, Sale. I would go to Sale and they had a lot of money. So
they've been
machines, all programmed in a strange programming language that couldn't really go so far. And it was, they're brilliant people. And McCarthy ran them out. But, you know, I'd watch, okay, they got a machine and somehow it goes over and picks up a blue ball real slowly and it puts it in a blue thing. And that wasn't quite like intelligence. I still don't believe so much in artificial intelligence at all. Because when I went back to college to get my degree, I had 1 year left to go. I had a plane crash, 5 weeks of amnesia. I went back to Berkeley under a fake name because my name was well known.
I
got my Berkeley diploma in the name Rocky Raccoon Park. But I went back as a psychology major. I wanted to study the brain as much as I could, memory and where it is. We don't know how the brain's wired.
Tell me how you got some of the parts of Hewlett Packard.
That was okay.
Because this is a radio thing also.
Sure. Now, Hewlett Packard, though, by then, a little over 20 years old, 21. Say.
Yeah. I knew parts and I knew formulas, you know, from ham radio and to build a few things that were just interesting for friends. And half of the friends knew all these new electronic companies were coming in the area. There were a lot of engineers, electrical engineers. So half the kids on my block were electronics kids. And we would do things together. We'd run wire down the fences and make house-to-house intercoms and just do things largely for fun. And that was
engineering dads from Lockheed or whatever.
Yeah, and buying communications receivers was so important, and having walkie-talkies, and you know, the radio world had been a large part of it. But so I don't know. I came up, and luckily I was really bright in mathematics. Mm-hmm. And when you combine electronics, a lot of people take electronics and kind of know how to hook these things together, read a lot of magazines, know what pieces will make a radio. But you add the math to that, and you've got really true engineering, you know, being able to design new things from scratch. So I was kind of in that role. And then digital, what was digital? I mean, analog is so pure. I mean, it's like there are parts that operate a certain way, and you learn it. You had to be a brainiac to be an electrical engineer.
We don't want to tell people, but digital is really analog.
Well, the funny thing is, we are engineers. And I don't call digital engineers, whether it's digital hardware with logic or programming. I don't call that, that's not the same type of engineering. You know, it's just not, oh my gosh, you know, putting together all these formulas and piecing together and testing. No, it's just, I don't know, writing stuff. They both create things. They're both makers, but I don't, not the same kind of engineering to me. So,
did you do anything in ham radio since it's a ham radio group?
Well, not exactly. I was 10 years old and, you know, and I got for Christmas Hallicrafters SX110 receiver and a SX120 transmitter, whatever the numbers were. And I built them. The manuals came, all the parts, step by step, soldering everything together. I really got a lot of learning of soldering and parts and how radio worked.
Any questions coming in online? The chat?
You made mention of the distinction between Austin and Silicon Valley. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
Yeah, so the contrast between what happened in Boston and what happened in Silicon Valley. The key thing was that back in Boston, a lot of the impetus for Silicon Valley came out of Boston. They had a professor there, but he taught most of these guys. He taught Kleiner and a bunch of these people. This management was a course on manufacturing that didn't cover anything about manufacturing, but it was on how to build a company, how to read the Wall Street Journal and those kinds of things. So they should have been successful. And they had one investment company that founded DEC. They sprang off a couple of mini computer companies, Data General, Wang, and so on. But as I said, they were vertically integrated. And I'll tell you a story about IBM. So IBM, in 1954, Johnson came out to California with the idea of starting a disk drive division away from New York. And he was told you'd probably ought to locate it in San Diego or Seattle, because that's where the big airframe companies were, and they were the customers for disk drives in those days. But he looked at them and he thought, I think I'm going to locate it in San Jose, because there was a Hollerith card company that he could mooch the accounting and HR off of in San Jose. So we started on Notre Dame Street in San Jose, and moved down to Cottle Road and started the big disk drive division there. And a bunch of guys down there, Stan Brown and a bunch of guys, decided that instead of having this head thing that moved back and forth using hydraulic fluid, you know, you'd turn it on, the fluid would go, and it'd go out, you'd stop it and drop a pin in, and you'd be on track. Instead of using hydraulic fluid, let's use electricity, use electronics. So they made a voice coil with huge magnets, and you'd put 48 volts and ground on it, and this thing would go whoosh, and you'd turn it over, you'd reverse the voltage, you'd go whoosh, and you could dither on the track and so on. You could make this thing go real fast back and forth, and there was no hydraulic fluid on the floor, which was kind of neat. And they said to IBM, isn't this a great idea? And IBM says, great idea. He says, but you don't understand our business. We lease these things. And if we started making these that are much better, we're going to have warehouses full of these hydraulic disk drives. Wait a couple of years until we get our inventory squared away, and then we'll start it. And they said, I don't think so. And they formed Information Storage Systems, which is where I worked in the early days. So I started at one of their buildings there, which later on became Tandem Computers. I was in the same building again. Now it's Apple, still in that same place there in Cupertino. But they left, and they could do it because California law allows that, right? We don't have you can't enforce non-compete clauses, and they made this better disk drive. Memorex and so on came out of that. So there's an example of why DEC and Route 128 don't succeed so well, because they're vertically integrated. If you're going to change your disk drive, you've got to change the channel, you've got to change the mainframe, you've got to change everything, and it's hard to pull that along. It's a much slower development cycle. Well, thank you so much for coming. We appreciate it. And I'll edit this, and I imagine there'll be a link somewhere on the West Valley ARA website that'll get people to the crux of what I gave you tonight. It's always been fun for me to dig into this history, see what happened before the birth of Silicon Valley with Hewlett and Packard, or whatever myth they've generated. It really goes way back to us hobbyists, and it's still mainly us hobbyists. These new companies. It's high school kids, college kids, new fresh out of college engineers getting together and doing what they love to do, which is try to make something better, try to disrupt the market.